Council Committee work session to order. We have one item on the agenda tonight. It is Agenda Bill 7306, Capital Budget Policy. And it says presented by Jennifer Olson, but she's not going to be here tonight. Instead, we have, I guess it takes four people to fill in for Jennifer. And Paul Winterstein and Mary Lou Polly are excused from tonight's meeting. So with that, who wants to start? Emily?
Administrator, and I'll be helping to facilitate a conversation. That's what Jen Olson had envisioned. This is an opportunity to ask some questions about the policy revisions that she has proposed. Christina Erickson from Finance Department is also here to help answer any questions that I'm not able to answer, and Beth Ann certainly will chime in if we both get it wrong, right? Okay. So I thought what we might do is, Jen gave an overview at the January Committee of the Whole session, and so I'm not going to repeat that presentation. What I thought we might do is start with the policy revisions themselves and kind of walk through those and talk about why each was recommended, and if there are alternatives, we can discuss those as well, and then I can answer any questions. So propose we look at it piece by piece.
So Emily, I wouldn't expect that you would give the whole overview that maybe Jen gave, but just for audience and somebody who might just pick it up later on as a video, you might explain what we are and what we're doing.
Yeah, thank you. Wisely recommended. So we are talking about potential revisions to the capital budget policy section of our financial policies. So we have financial policies that deal with reserve fund levels, debt service obligations, et cetera. And there is a section that deals with our capital budget. And it's a very simple section right now. We worked with a group from ICMA a couple years ago to analyze our policy and our process. They spent a lot of time on our process and helped to provide some recommendations on how we might meet state law, best practices across the country for local governments, and then meet our very local needs in terms of what the expectations were from council members, because they conducted focus groups, and they also spoke with each of our department directors who have the bulk of the responsibility of drafting the capital plan each year. So at this point, what Jen has proposed to you are changes to that capital budget policy. There certainly are other changes to practices and procedures that would accompany the change in policy, but as she expressed, we always like to lead with policy changes first. That then drives sort of the path that you want to chart for your implementation. So that's where we are, looking at the revisions to the capital budget policy. So Jen did us a good service by helping to identify the key changes in the policy in red font. So I'm going to just start with objectives. She spoke at the last meeting about how it's important to first center your policy in objectives. And so here she has objective as support the strategic plan. And I'll just interject. She and I have had lots of conversations on this topic. One of the things we talked about that I noted today didn't get revised is we talked about this line being support strategic plans, because we have master plans, say, for the park system and utilities. And so that's one revision that I might suggest. There are a couple more places where when Christina and I looked at it again, of course, after Jen had gone to Minnesota, we found a couple of places that we're going to point out tonight that might need minor tweaks. Tonight's purpose is just to talk about the policy and answer your questions, but Jen laid out a timeline that included a public hearing in early March to get community feedback on policy changes, and then subsequent to that, I think at the second regular meeting in March, that was the moment in time when we were gonna have incorporated all that feedback from tonight, from the public hearing, and bring you a final proposed policy for you to consider. So tonight we don't have to get it perfect. So support the strategic plans and community vision for growth and levels of service. Acknowledge and communicate capital investment priorities and dynamics. Ensure appropriate responses to changing demands on a diverse infrastructure and capital assets. A financial assessment of capital funding resources available to meet future capital project planning needs according to the financial policy. Maintain a high quality service infrastructure capable of meeting community needs today and in the future. So these are the objectives for a capital budget that she has proposed. And again, we're looking for that policy level, high vision, kind of governance input from all of you. If there is word choice that's offensive or that you think can be improved upon, by all means suggest it, but we're really interested in the big picture feedback from you. Did we list the right objectives? Are there any we forgot?
Can I ask what, well, one of the comments I'll have about the first one, support strategic plans, I realize we don't have one right now.
Right.
And so I have strongly advocated for one, like you heard me say many times. And so to take out strategic plan that's not capitalized and just generally refer to strategic planning, I guess I would support leaving it in and maybe parentheses other strategic plans,
okay.
Because it kind of signals that we're planning to create a strategic plan and that we won't need to go back and change this document once we do that. And then every time we look at this document, we're reminded that we're supposed to have a strategic plan. Mm-hmm. And then in the second sentence, what is the word dynamics supposed to mean? Priorities and dynamics.
I would bet that she meant changing needs in the community.
And is there a difference between objectives and goals? If you don't know, then you don't know. I just, for some reason, there's something in the back of my mind where I had a conversation with the council member, and I don't know who that is right now. The difference between objectives and goals. Anyway.
Yeah, and you're right. I refer to them as objectives, so I was inferring they're synonymous, and they may not be, but.
Maybe they're not. Maybe the first paragraph is the objective, and then just the second list is the goals. So mm-hmm. That's probably my misreading.
I think it was probably me, the conversation about goals and objectives. And I think objectives are measurable and goals are not, I think is historically how it works.
Okay.
But I'd have to go back and look.
Hmm. Any questions, comments about the list of goals up here? Eileen?
Mm-hmm. Whose responses? I mean, because there's probably a number of different visions out in the community in regards to what
sure.
this response could be. But the changing demands of the diverse infrastructure and capital assets, that's important, but I'm not sure I'm following the first three words, ensuring appropriate response.
Sure, so we could debate whether each of those three words is the appropriate word, but I think what's meant, what the intent is there, is that the capital plan should put into place a plan to provide for the changing demands, the needs of our infrastructure and capital assets. So, for example, ensure an appropriate response to, this is all hypothetical, a failing water utility system might be to invest in some capital projects in your utility system.
Because you just used the word plan, and I think plan is a more action word than simply just giving them a response.
Mariah?
I just had a question on the last bullet point, the word mm-hmm. capable. Maintain a high-quality service infrastructure capable of meeting community needs today and in the future, if there was mm-hmm. a point to that, mm-hmm. And whether that should be in there or not mm-hmm. in there. Sort of means, you know, to me that, well, that could happen.
Sure.
So the other way would be a little more definitive, mm-hmm. but maybe there was a reason, mm-hmm. and it's just because it's tied to the future.
Mm-hmm. I see it less as not suggesting that the system doesn't meet the needs today, but more that it should be able to meet the future needs. So it's prospective. It's able to meet community needs today and into the future.
Okay. Comments or questions on the bullet points? Ready to move on? Looks like we're moving down to capital improvement plan where it says 6 to 10 years.
Yes. So I should have also mentioned that all of these suggested additions and edits not only came from recommendations from that ICMA team, but from staff that has experience with capital planning elsewhere in our finance department and outside of that department, and in looking at best practices across the country and from the Governmental Finance Officers Association. So a variety of sources have led to these recommendations, and I'll try to point to those where it's appropriate. So here's one. Capital improvement plans are typically multi-year plans, as Jen has expressed to you. And more often than not, those capital plans on average run 5 to 10 years. And so certainly there are a lot of communities that have plans that run 6 to 10 encompass the next 6 years, shall we say, or the next 10 years would be another way to say it. So that's typical. You won't see many capital plans out there that are fewer years. And certainly if you go beyond 10 years, there's a lot more uncertainty about funding sources, ability to complete projects, what projects are actually needed to meet demands. Oh. So right now, our current plan, you guys recall exactly what it says? I don't think it says multiple year. Also, we have this new differentiation that Jen spoke about between a CFP, a capital facilities plan, and the capital improvement plan. So we're renaming this to differentiate between what's in the comprehensive plan for the capital facilities element and is required by GMA with what is more typical for a city to have, and that's a capital improvement plan, the first year of which typically gets incorporated into the operating budget, so those projects get funded.
So can you mm-hmm. explain that first sentence at where the end of it says 6 to 10 years, intends to make over a period of 6 to 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
What does that plan look like? What I'm trying to visualize what 6 to 10 years means.
Sure. Well, I think practically speaking, what we would do is pretty similar to what we have today. We have years 1 through 6 of planning level capital projects that have a greater degree of cost estimation done, of scoping done. And then I think we've had some discussion about having a place for a little bit longer out into the future projects so that they can be at least listed. And those eventually get wrapped up into the CIP as they start to be further developed, and year 8 moves up and becomes year 6, and then they land in the plan. So I think there was a degree to leave that open to start with a 6-year plan as we have, and then to have the ability to extend our planning horizon, although it might look a little different for year 7 through 10 in terms of the degree of detail on those projects.
So does it make I'm wondering if it makes sense in this section to have a separate sentence about where years 1 through 5 or 1 through 6
mm-hmm.
are, which puts these 6 to 10 years in context.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think my confusion is if we just moved up the word years to before six, or a period of years or.
Okay.
For years 6 to 10, because I thought you were asking a question, should it be somewhere between 6 and 10 years?
Okay, I got you. Okay, another thing that just popped into my head is Jen may have also meant to suggest that if you get a project in year 6 that is only ready for design in year 6, it actually is a project that is foreseen to happen in 7, 8, 9, or 10 in terms of a construction project. So I think that's also why she gave a range is, you may have a project in your planning horizon that's ready to be incorporated into your CIP years 1 through 6, but it's actually not completed until a future year. I understand your suggested edit, though.
Any questions on years 6 to 10? Okay. Next one, annual. I assume it's because you're going to raise the issue of annual budgets.
Yeah, here I think she just wanted to clarify that it is incorporated each year, and we do go through a capital budget process each year, and we'll talk a little bit more about what that will look like. And then, yes, I think eventually we're hoping that we can move to a biennial budget, and that would include both operating and capital. But for now, it's annual, and it will always be incorporated into the current year operating budget. Okay.
No. Next.
So the next one is the CIP criteria and ranking. And before we look in depth at that, I think there are two ways that we could approach this. Jen chose to include it as an exhibit and attach it to the policy. We don't always attach the implementation tools to the policy itself to allow for some flexibility in those implementation tools. I think she wanted to ensure that we were going to have a good conversation about the criteria and be very transparent about the fact that we would be rating projects. But I see you having sort of two alternatives on this. You can, at the policy level, just voice your support or lack thereof for rating projects and give us some input on that criteria, and then we can take that policy direction and go and figure out what the implementation tool looks like and do that work. Or if you want to get into the particulars of the implementation tool, then you have it right here as an exhibit that's referenced in the policy and really codifies it to a greater degree. So I wanted to just express that to you. So if you find that you're getting hung up on terms, that's one way for you to at least say rating is a good idea, go do rating, but we don't need to necessarily wordsmith all of it. So Exhibit A has two parts. I'm going to have you turn to the second part first. Let me see if I can get to it on screen. And that's the longer table, this table. It's called Rating Criteria, Weights, Scoring, and Project Ranking. And so Jen has listed some criteria on that left side, beginning with legal mandate, then public health and safety. And then she's given some definition to that criteria. So legal mandate is broken down by, is it a court decision? Is it a regulatory requirement? Is it because of pending legal action or potential legal action or a regulatory requirement, or it has normal project liability? And then she's assigned simple prioritization, you know, scale 1 to 5, and then a weight to that category, and given it a maximum score. In this case, the weight is 3 and the max score is 15. So she has all these categories, all the kind of sub-definitions, and the total score adds up to possibility of 100 points. Now I'm going to flip back that 100 points. Christina and I were talking just today about this. You'll see the intent here is to rate each project, get it an assigned value based on that table I just showed you, and then situate it into one of these bands. So the absolute score is not as important, say, as which band it falls in. So when we discuss projects, we'd rather elevate above the simple numeric score and talk about level of importance of that project. And here she has five different types of importance: essential, desirable, acceptable, deferrable, or on hold. And the 100 points is problematic because you can see we have this scoring over here for an essential project of 100 or 100 plus points. Well, there's no way to score more than 100. And so Christina and I were thinking this is a place that needs a little tweak. So we might want to create this band as being, say, 90 to 100. So we may need to make some adjustments on this table. The other thing that Christina and I were talking about is what sort of distribution would you want to see in your projects? Is it reasonable to think about, you know, 10 or 15% being on the tails, right, for on hold and deferrable or essential and desirable? Or is it true that because these projects come up from strategic plans and community ideas and also from the departments that are managing these assets, would it be more likely true that a higher number, higher percentage of the projects would probably fall, you know, above the acceptable line? So your curve wouldn't be a bell curve, it would be some other shape, right? J curve or something. So right now you can't get that shape with the score being what it is, because it would be really hard to score 100 points. We'd have to have all of our project raters agree. So we're going to make some adjustments to that scoring column, but what I'd like to talk about is, first, from a policy perspective, does it make sense for us to look at our capital plan in a more comprehensive way and think about how one project might relate in importance to the rest of the projects in our portfolio? Right now, we bring forward projects in our parks plan, projects in our water plan, and we don't ever talk about, given the total amount of money and the time and energy we have to do capital projects, how do we prioritize across all projects? So this system would allow us to at least have that conversation.
Is this typically how other?
Yes.
They have a point system? And
yeah, and some have a more simplified system. We were talking about this today too. It's not uncommon to see them create bands that are low, medium, high priority bands. Again, if your intent is just to have a good quality discussion about how to commence on your capital plan, where to make your investments. But a lot of communities do rating systems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just having worked with many rating systems before, like the thing you brought up of where they're going to fall, until you start really putting things in there, they all may fall into a desirable kind of thing, and then what do you do, right? Mm-hmm. So somehow you kind of have to practice that a little bit, I think, and see where those are, because they should be, I mean, things that don't rate out probably shouldn't be on our plan to begin with, right?
Right. So,
but yeah, how they actually, mm-hmm. you know, that where you make those splits is going to be critical to run through that a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. We would anticipate there will be some learning. We're going to learn from just applying the numbers, but we're also going to learn about how to talk about what's essential and what's not. You know, every good department director is going to make his or her case for their infrastructure assets, and that's great. We want people to be passionate about the things they manage, but when we have finite resources, we also have to have a way of talking about which one needs to come first.
That sounds like an argument for a strategic plan.
It all goes together. It does.
I haven't worked with rating systems before, and I don't really have any substantive comments in addition to the observations that you've already made. That anybody else?
On the long one, I have a comment.
Go ahead.
Sure.
And again, getting into the details, but under environmental impact, the fourth and fifth choice, it actually score positive points when you say have a minor negative environmental impact would score like mm-hmm. 6 points and diminishes the environment and still score 3 points. I have a problem with things that are diminishing the environment scoring any positive points. Those two kind of jumped out at me is something. You have to get to that those kind of categories, I guess, but they shouldn't be scoring points.
I understand your feedback.
Makes sense.
Yeah, unless there's some reason that came from somewhere, so I don't know what the reason is.
I think, again, it's just applying consistency across these criteria, having a 1 to 5 scale, and trying to define what a 1 might be.
I think the rating system and having that backup information and just the transparency of this is the criteria and the rating system that are used is a good idea. I just wondered if, well, it was sort of to Bill's point about, you know, everything falling into a desirable category, mm-hmm. but also if there were a project that was just always scoring a little bit lower. Maybe it was preservation of facility or conforming to city plans and goals or something that kept coming up, but
sure.
within the plan, you know, it, mm-hmm. it wasn't rising to the top. Just, mm-hmm. I don't really have an answer, but it's just something that popped into my head.
So. Yeah, I think to some degree, it's wise for us to approach this as a trial, you know, a little pilot program. We're going to have to see how it really works in practice and what sort of adjustments need to happen. Christina and I also had a conversation about just looking at the funding criteria. Does it make sense the way that we have it, or should we even apply a higher weight to a project that already has funding established? Because there's already been some commitment on behalf of the municipality for that because funding has been received. So I think we need to play with it a little bit. That's why I was sort of articulating there's two choices here. You can really codify the criteria, or we can just say in the policy we're going to do it and make the tool accessible to people so they know what's being done, but not necessarily carve it into stone, so we have some opportunities to modify it over time.
Yeah, and then there's just the, like you sort of referenced, there's just the reality.
Right.
You know, you might have something that's falls in the middle, and all of a sudden you get some, a huge grant available.
Right.
Or something happens in the community where you need to replace that capital asset.
Right.
And it's never going to be something that's, you said, carved in stone, which can't be. I mean, the planning tool.
It is, very much. It's a planning tool. This is a instrument to use in that planning effort. To your point, Stacy, we even have a line in this section just a little further down from where Exhibit A is in red. I'll point this out as one of the caveats because I think it's really important. It says, administration will assess project rankings plus other factors such as minimizing construction impacts through project sequencing or a need to respond to emergent issues. Those are just examples, but as you suggested, I would hate to have a project that scores 89, you know, when it's initially scored, and another one that's 94, and let's say those are in different bands, and then all of a sudden it have something happen to whatever that project is that got the 89 and not feel like we had the ability to elevate it and get it done ahead of the one that scored 94.
I think more often than not, you might find that there are projects, they're not as close as 89 and 94. It's gonna be 89
True.
And 63, and all of a sudden,
yes,
you know, half of the project funds are potentially available in a grant, and then you've got the tougher decision to make.
Yeah, 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 so I think scoring is just one of the ways we'll make decisions about capital projects, but I think it's there's added value to doing it where we're not doing it now.
Other questions about that? Ready to move on to the next page? Or did you have a question, Bill?
I do have one more. I think I saw it earlier in the last existing policy, and I'm trying to find it again here as I looked earlier, but I'm not finding anything, and I think this is where it should be on public input.
Oh, sure. We can talk about
that. And so maybe you can help, because I was just glancing quickly and not finding where I thought I saw it earlier, so I think it was an existing one. So I'm not seeing anything here on that.
Sure. I can speak to that. It's mentioned briefly in the last paragraph entitled Planning Process, but there's not a lot of detail. So I can talk to you a little bit about what we envision that will entail. So capital budget planning starts even with the community engagement around strategic plans, right? So they help to establish needs and wants and levels of investment even. And so there's public engagement at that point. Then those plans help to inform what should go into the capital budget. Capital budget is also informed by department's infrastructure monitoring. And then when the CIP is proposed, there's a public involvement process to look at the full document, make sure that resonates well with community priorities. And then once those conceptual projects get incorporated into the CIP and the CIP is adopted, then individual projects, depending on their attributes, have community involvement processes as well.
But what I'm thinking is here, as you're working on the adoption of a CIP,
mm-hmm.
as you mentioned there's a public project process step, and
sure.
I think we should state that in that. I think this is the best place it fits, but somewhere I'd like to see that actually stated.
Okay.
Just that piece where the CIP is going to have obviously all this stuff is going to come before.
Sure.
There'll be specific for projects afterwards, but the CIP itself will have that step of a public process
okay.
through it.
Yep.
You can put it wherever you want, but.
Sounds good. We can add that. And I think Jen also gave, it's not in the policy, so I understand your point, but I think she also gave you a timeline that shows where those opportunities
are. I think it needs to be stated in here.
Okay.
In the financial policies stated that?
Criteria and ranking, and so you talked about the CIP going through the approval process, and this is kind of the approval process here, what I'm seeing. So, like I say, I don't see any other place that fits any better.
Sure. Bill,
there's something out there.
Yeah, it's really in that last paragraph where it talks about engagement efforts to ensure the community has ample time to comment on and contribute to the CIP.
There you go. All right.
So I
somewhere just
yeah, I think it's there, and we'll look at ways to maybe enhance it. The other thing that I might mention under that topic of community engagement is we are also contemplating adding a step to our process that we don't have now that will fit really nicely, I think, with our neighborhood engagement program. Some communities, in addition to believing that projects originate from those strategic plan conversations, also do a kind of direct solicitation for project ideas. The thought being that, most of your parks and open space kind of project ideas come from your parks planning effort, but every once in a while a neighborhood gets together and says, gosh, what we really need in our neighborhood is X, right? And any of those neighbors could walk into any of your council meetings and propose that. But if you have a moment in time in your process where you open up that opportunity and welcome it, and then our intent would be to do that as the capital budget is being developed, but the project itself that gets sponsored by the neighborhood may not get incorporated until that next iteration of your capital plan. But what tends to work well is to have that open solicitation, get the sponsored idea, and then to sit down with the neighborhood and work on the scoping, develop the cost estimates, do the project rating, situate it then in your next CIP. So that's what we would propose.
H? Yep. Oh, Mariah
just had one more question.
Sure.
At the end of the the paragraph, the CIP criteria and ranking, the last sentence, it says projects shall also be identified as unfunded, partially funded, or fully funded. I just wonder if maybe some, based on what we were just talking about, maybe some language could be added beyond just identified. I don't know if it would be given weight, if it were
actually
funded or...
It does correspond to the weighting. So you'll see on that long table that projects that have some funds identified get scored, get a higher point total.
Okay. Thank you.
But and what the policy also suggests is that when you get your CIP plan, you will be able to turn to a project sheet and see the funding, the anticipated funding sources, or there are already known funding sources for that project. So you'll know if it's funded, partially funded, unfunded, et cetera.
Okay. First page or the second page? We're not going to flip till you're done.
Okay. All right. So the next section, project source and use identification.
Yes.
On the last line there, it talks about including all the stuff from inflationary costs and contingency. I'm focusing on the word contingency because in the existing policy, mm-hmm. I like the wording that was there, and it's not here. So,
Can you tell me exactly where you are on the new policy?
The first paragraph, project source and use identification.
Yes.
Okay. On the fourth line down, it says the second word, and contingency.
Very last line on,
page.
Okay.
Basically says all the costs should be included in a project, mm-hmm. including contingency, right?
Yes.
Okay, and which is fine. What I'm saying, if you go back to our existing plan, so I'm gonna flip back that on page 10, what you wanna look at, 15 to 26, or page 10 of the existing plan, it's item mm-hmm. three,
policy.
Contingencies.
Yes, existing policy.
Existing policy, right. Okay. Go back to the existing policy. If I can get you on that page there, it's item three, contingencies.
Mm-hmm.
Where you find that?
Yeah, I can scroll to it.
All right. So the last part of that paragraph says, project contingencies shall not be expended to cover change orders resulting from increases in project scope unless specifically authorized by city council. So I like that, we need to have contingencies there. I don't have a problem with that, but this talks about what contingencies are for and not what they're not for. And that's not specified in our new plan. So I don't want it to be contingent, because I think about, a $4 million project where your contingency is almost $500,000. You could easily, if you're right on target, you could spend an extra $500,000 on something to add to the things you didn't have in the contract. Yeah. And I like the fact that, if we're going to add things to that, then they need to come back to council. Makes sense. So somehow that part from the existing policy get carried into the new policy on what contingencies are really for. And what they are for is, an unanticipated increase in cost of what we're trying to do, not something in addition. Classic is, Central Park. If we want to add those things in, we would agree to add those in. Make sense? Thank you.
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble getting it to pull up, but I am following where you are.
I can show you later if need be.
Yeah, I see what you're looking at. I just, for some reason, can't get the document.
You have to go back and forth.
Open correctly. Okay, I understand your suggestion. Wasn't quite on this section yet, but I can talk about the intent on contingency. It was also to... In our practice side, the implementation side, is to get a little bit more scientific about what level of contingency we budget for a project. You know this. You start out with a different percentage when you're in concept, right? And then as you go and there are fewer unknowns about a project, it's more fully designed, even to the point where you now have bids in hand, you can start to reduce your contingency over time on your planning continuum. That's true. It's also true that a road project's level of contingency often needs to look different than a facility project. And so type of project also matters. And so behind the scenes, we're going to get more scientific about that and give direction to our staff. When you're doing a project that's a A-type project, you need to budget, you know, this type of contingency. Or if it's at this level of planning effort, it needs that level of contingency. So we haven't spelled that out here, but that's what we're anticipating doing.
That's fine. That just didn't answer my question, though.
As to whether to add that sentence, I'm open to what the council would like to do. I understood it that you want to add some clarity, bring that sentence forward so that council would have the say in approving contingency to be used for something other than a plan scope.
Right.
Change order.
One that starts with project contingency funds should only be used to pay for unforeseen.
Right.
Okay. Emily has that suggestion. Okay.
Good.
Anything else on that one page?
No, thank you.
Yeah. Next page. Next sources.
Hey, there's the old one. All right. Project sources. Jen just tried to, hey, Christina, can you see if you can get this open, this proposed policy? You can play with this. Project sources. Jen just wanted to be more transparent about the types of sources that we have for funding. Our capital plan doesn't have an infinite number of funding sources, and then there certainly are sources that are prescribed by state law and restricted by state law. So she's listed those. It's just a simple list of the typical funding sources for capital projects. Yeah. Awesome. Thanks. I think.
So the only thing I don't see listed there is private funds. One of those would be, could be, if you really listen to sources, there's folks that may come to us with those as well. State Park has private funds in there and other ones.
Great. Thank you.
Any other comments on that list? If none, we're going to move down to project costs.
Great. So project costs, this is a section that we've made a significant change in. We're differentiating between what's a capital outlay item and a capital project. And so previously we had a lower dollar threshold for where you cross over from capital outlay to capital project. And it was too low for a city of our size, population-wise or budget-wise. And so we were out of the norm. And also what that meant is things that typically should have been incorporated into our ongoing annual operating budget were finding themselves in the capital project plan. And so what we have proposed is to set that threshold now at 50,000. A capital project is anything that's an investment or purchase of more than 50,000 and would have a minimum lifespan of 3 years. That's another policy choice, is how many years. Some cities set their minimum lifespan for a capital asset as 5 years. Our team chose three, that's in part, I think, just a recommendation based on what we have typically put in our capital budget by moving the threshold up, what we have done is we've said those smaller dollar equipment purchases, for example, now need to get incorporated into the operating budget. So you don't want to set it so high, you know, $100,000, because our operating budget can't absorb, from a funding source perspective, all of those smaller projects or pieces of equipment. So you have to find the sweet spot. So this will be a big change for our organization. We'll have to have departments that are asking through our annual operating budget process for replacement equipment, where they usually try to put it into the capital plan. So that's one outcome of this. It changes our operating budget as well. Those assets are still identified. The needs are still brought forward. It's just a matter of which plan they go into and what available funding sources they would have.
Then general vehicles would be part of replacement at this point. It wouldn't be in the capital. Obviously, larger vehicles and specialty vehicles would, but regular cars, pickups, and so forth would be part of the operating cost, the way I see that now. So for that three-year life, I don't know if they have the 3 to 5 year life on a vehicle, so that might kick it back into a capital. So that's a question I guess I have. That's most common vehicles to me, 3 to 5 years. So, and it's an or, so
yeah.
You buy a $25,000 vehicle, but it's got a 5 year lifespan, then it would have to go back into capital budget. It's written. Mm-hmm. So yep. If you want vehicles in or out, that might be something to think about.
The sources we had for this recommendation was the Department of Commerce says that most jurisdictions define their capital facilities threshold somewhere between 10,000 and 50,000. But as I said, fewer and fewer are at that $10,000 limit just as our communities grow. We sampled a bunch of different cities, Tacoma being a larger city. They set theirs at $50,000, but a longer life expectancy threshold. So you can put a bunch of different criteria on. This is what we think is reasonable for our city. But it's a move in the right direction as well. Helps to differentiate between regular ongoing kind of smaller replacements and the larger capital projects.
Want to make another suggestion, or are you just?
No, I'm throwing it your way. Whether you want that 5 year or not versus 3 year might simplify it for you. I don't care. I think 50,000 is a good mark. 3 to 5 years somewhere in there is a good mark. It works for me. Whichever is easier for you.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? All right.
I have on the other same paragraph.
In that same paragraph.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Project cost, second paragraph. 1, 2, 3, 4. Fifth line. Starts the sentence with projects.
Okay.
I don't understand this sentence. After reading stuff says projects may not be separated to forego maximum standard and should be period.
Yeah, we came across that too. I think there should be a period after the word standard, and we should strike through and should be. We think it's just a cut and paste error.
All right. I was wondering if it ended there or there was something I was missing. One or the other. Mm-hmm.
And the line right above that, projects may not be combined to meet the minimum standard unless they are dependent upon each other.
Mm-hmm.
Is there criteria for what?
It's very situational. So example, I think sort of referenced somewhere else, I guess not that paragraph, is a road and utility project. So if the utility relocation or upgrade was a lower dollar amount, lower than 50,000, normally then it wouldn't meet that criteria, would meet the age criteria, lifespan criteria, but not the dollar value criteria. And so it wouldn't naturally be a capital project on its own, but because you want to do utilities at the same time you're working on the pavement, we usually try to combine those. So that's what's meant by it. If it makes sense to combine, but if they're not really related, don't try to combine just to get it above the capital project threshold so that you get your project approved.
Separate it to below.
Or separate it to get below. It kind of spells out some fighting rules, yeah.
Maybe I'm just dense, but why I can see why somebody might try to break something up to get below the threshold. Why would somebody try to aggregate to get above the threshold?
To get above or below? I'm sorry.
I said I understand why somebody might try to disentangle to get things below the threshold.
But why above?
Yeah. Why?
Same reason. If the perception was that there's more funds available to capital projects in a given year than in an operating budget.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like the last impact on operating budget.
Yes. So this section is meant to just demonstrate that we are going to be cognizant about how capital projects ripple to the operating budget. So if you build a new facility, you may need to staff that facility and maintain that facility, et cetera. And so there's an impact on your operating budget. You might view that as a negative impact. There could also be a positive impact where that new facility might generate revenue. So this section is meant as guidance to staff to say, need to spend some effort in quantifying that, again, so that it will help us to make good decisions about capital investment.
Comments or questions, Bill?
Yeah, did you have one? I like that.
I do too.
Thank you.
I was looking specifically about where the word maintenance was, because we hear that over and over and over again. Impact to personnel and maintenance in particular.
Okay. Great, so now we just walked through the policy and...
Wait, there's another paragraph.
What?
There's another section.
There's another
Oh, there is another one. There was no red ink there, but I'd be happy to take any comments.
But I can talk
feedback
about things that aren't in red ink. So the wording here, and it's a planning process, mm-hmm. and thank you, we found the public input I wanted. And after that, it talks about the mayor administration will present the CIP to City Council for approval prior to the start of the annual operating budget development. So then changes the CIP after approval must be approved by the council.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the one thing I'm not sure of in the reading of that is to approve the capital budget for the year. It seems to me, I'm reading that we're approving the capital budget for the year without approving the operating budget, which the two go together, and I couldn't say I want to approve that capital before I know what's in the operating and where we are. So that, I'm not sure that I'm just not reading that clearly, but I don't want to approve a capital budget and say that's part of the operating budget, and now we're going to do the operating budget.
So
am I reading that wrong?
It may help to think about it this year. You're approving a six-year plan, and then you get to have a subsequent conversation about, shall we take the first year of that plan and can our operating budget accomplish that? And then you have that opportunity then to revise year one of your CIP as it gets incorporated into your operating budget. So it's a little chicken and egg. We've talked about this with council before. You know, which one do you want to see first? And certainly we've adopted an operating budget before we've adopted a capital plan, a six-year plan. I think this way, when you have a conversation about the capital needs of the community and you settle on what the plan is going to be, then you have an opportunity to then apply as an overlay what the financial ability is, and can you take that first year in whole or in part and put it into your operating budget.
Yeah, as long as we have that process that way, you're not approving that first year that you're carrying into, you're just the whole plan. I'm good with that
then.
Thank you.
Ola.
So I guess I'm still a little murky. So if you have, walk me through on how on any given year,
mm-hmm.
if you've got a six-year plan and there's something that people, leadership, council, mayoral, want to see in that year, how does that follow through during the course of the year in the budget development?
So a project that is already identified as being a year one project or a different project?
A different project.
So the thought being that if you have a six-year plan and you have year one, the intent of staff would be to take that year one and put it into the operating budget. Now, we would tell you if during that gap in our timelines, if something dramatic had happened on the operating budget that we thought it wasn't wise to take all of the projects in year one and put them into your next year operating budget, we would provide you that input. Conversely, if we thought there was room for something else, we could have that conversation as well. It doesn't preclude, I think, council from suggesting another capital project. You know, certainly want to have good, robust conversation about leapfrogging, right? Council would be aware during that operating budget deliberation process what additional resources might be available, and then could have a conversation about how to utilize that extra funding. Shall it be capital? Shall it be a program, et cetera? Does that answer your question?
It does. Okay.
So, I want to make sure my understanding is correct. So, the CIP would come to City Council and be presented, this is what we know, mm-hmm. and council can influence that.
Mm-hmm.
And then that also, by adopting that, also helps inform, it's part of the process by which the City Council informs the administration regarding budget priorities as well.
Sure.
And is that right?
Yes.
And so then things might change. You're also making recommendations based on what you know about the upcoming budget season
yeah,
so far.
On the non-capital side as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then those priorities, mm-hmm. council could change things during the budget, and subsequently, if a CIP was approved, then the administration can't change that CIP substantively unless the council approves.
Sure.
Changes.
Right. And I think at that point in time, if there was a difference in the adopted CIP year one and the annual budget's incorporation of that year, then I think you'd have a couple of choices. We could go back immediately and change the CIP, or given the amount of time, it's probably only a couple months before we're back at preparing the next iteration of the CIP, and we just incorporate those changes as well. Although it wouldn't be a year one project adjustment, it would be if that rippled to year two through six. That makes sense.
Do you have any other questions or comments? What else do you need from us tonight?
So I think it would be very helpful. So I've got your comments. We'll incorporate those. The next step is the public hearing. We'll start to get those modifications made so that it's available to the public. And then you have another meeting date where you're to have another discussion about this and those revisions. I think the piece that I would be helpful to hear is, do you want the rating instrument itself to be embedded in the policy or just reference that there is one?
Where would it show up if not in the policy?
I'm envisioning that we're going to have a lot more information on our website for our capital budget process and capital planning, and so we could post it there, for example. It could also be put into the plan as a, you know, reference chapter at the back.
So my thoughts about first and foremost, transparency. Mm-hmm. So if it was always to show up in the plan itself, that would be fine. It wouldn't something that we'd have to find on the website. It would always show up. You could also find it on the website, but it would always show up in the plan. It's always there.
Mm-hmm.
My concern about putting it, attaching it with the policy, is that I would envision that I'm guessing that the rating system might get tweaked, particularly mm-hmm. in the first few years as we're testing this, which mm-hmm. Means, I guess we'd have to pull the budget policy out and change it, unless the rating system is policy that we need to adopt, and then not sure it matters which way it goes. But as long as it's readily available, I don't really have a huge problem. Is the rating system policy?
So I think in that section, it starts off criteria, Project ranking and overall priority guidelines will be established by the City Council and found in Exhibit A. So instead, we could say will be utilized to evaluate and rank projects. You certainly have provided input, but I think the difference is whether you establish it and whether it's listed as an exhibit to the policy or if it's just referenced as.
Just and instead of saying it attached as Exhibit A, can we just say included as in the CIP? I mean,
I tend to like that. So when the CIP, when people see it got 85 points, their favorite project, they can actually look at what the rating criteria was and go, oh, I wish that I got 100, but now I can see why it didn't. So that might be a handier place to keep it, and then we wouldn't have to come back and keep changing it, they say, particularly this first year or so. So as long as it's attached to something, that makes sense to me.
It would just keep it comparable to other projects.
I like that idea.
That's where the score, people are going to see the scores. They're going to see a project and they're going to score, see an 85 or whatever. That won't mean anything if they don't have it.
If they don't have the relationship.
Right.
Right. And it just to clarify, I don't know that we've settled on this, but we might show it as which band it's in instead of the raw score because, again, you know, plus or minus, it's depending on a lot of factors. So I might just show it as a band.
I guess just to follow up then, if it's, I would keep the part referenced in here about that it's a policy, the rating system is, not just the bands, but the rating system is a policy.
Mm-hmm.
We've had so many questions over the last couple of years about whether we're certain rankings are policy or not. I think they are, and so I think if we're intending it to be policy, it should say that somewhere. Yep, Tola.
I think the actual raw score should be in there because there's a lot of people in the city that are engineering nerds like myself who are really into the numbers. And I think it'll just generate, it's just from a transparency. I don't think it'll generate a lot of negatives if you have it in, but I think if you don't have it in, it'll generate confusion.
Yeah.
Okay. I agree. I just, you know, don't want to bicker about, should really be a 74 when 73, big picture.
You have nice wide bands on each of the categories. Mm-hmm. It's not like it's a 5-point band, and so like a 1-point change in one of the scores is going to kick it out of a given band.
Shouldn't, and if it does, then I would argue that's something that we need to look at and say, is it right to have it below this number, or should it be above in comparison to others? So that's the kind of flexibility I think we want to utilize the tool to have.
What else do you need from us?
Do we think we have what we need? Okay.
Anything else? Some members? So we would normally have public comment, but just for those watching and for the record, we don't have anybody from the public here tonight. So if there isn't anything else, we are don't have a good of the order for work sessions. All right, we're adjourned.
Thanks.